Okay, so I guess it started recording, and okay, so let's continue from where we left last time. Last time we did this second version of Hensel's lemma, and we also started looking at the structure of periodic fields. So by a periodic field, we mean you have a discrete valuation ring. And you are taking the quotient field of it. Okay, and we looked at the structure. So let's come to the slides and start today's lecture. Lecture 4. So, can you please confirm that this is visible? Okay, so 1 second.
Yes, it's visible.
1 second, 1 second. Yeah, so sorry. Let me start sharing again. Visible, no? Manu?
Yes.
Okay, so let's start lecture 4. So today, I don't know whether you have seen such a thing in any other course. Have you seen something called the inverse limit or projective limit in algebra?
No.
Okay. Anyway, it's a simple enough concept. We need not have introduced it. We have another way of doing it, but I thought let's introduce some terms. Okay. And then we will show that if you assume O by P is finite, then we will show that O is compact. And then we will compute a certain index, okay, certain index, and we will show that it is finite. So this index that I am going to compute, you will take units, and you will take its, so this is an abelian group, so you can take its mth power. You take an m and take all x power m, and we will compute, so that will be a subgroup because it's abelian. And we will compute its index. Okay, so that's all that we will do today. So last to last class, that is lecture 2. Last to last class, we saw one version of Hensel's lemma, and in the last class, we saw another version. Okay, so maybe I will have to. Sorry. Maybe I'll have to, so I'm sitting in my balcony. I will have to switch the place. A lot of eagles or kites fighting right in front of me. So some 5 or 6. Okay, let's see. I hope they don't come inside. So in the last class, we saw another version. So we have two versions of Hensel's lemma. And both these versions are generalizations of the so-called trivial case of the Hensel's lemma, which also I stated last time. So this stated that if you have a polynomial f with coefficients in the ring of integers O, and if its bar after reduction modulo p, if that has a simple root, then that root can be lifted, and that will be a simple root. Okay, so this was a trivial case, and we have seen two generalizations. Then we started looking at the structure of periodic fields, and we saw two filtrations. So filtration, I mean just a descending chain. So the first filtration was O containing, P square containing, etc. And then we have units. So this I denoted by U, and this I denoted by U1, this is U2, etc. So U containing, U1 containing, U2 containing, etc. So these two filtrations we have. And we also studied what the successive quotients are, right? So what is successive quotient here? What is p power I by p power I plus 1? That we showed is isomorphic to O by P. And here, the very first one, O star by 1 plus P is isomorphic to O by P star, the non-zero elements of O by P. And all the other successive quotients are isomorphic to P power I by P power I plus 1, which in turn is isomorphic to O by P. All these isomorphisms are as groups. Okay, so that also we saw last time and we will use it again today. So today we will first show that O and U, O star, both these are compact, not in this generality, but under the assumption that O by P is finite. Okay, so assuming this, we will show that O and O star are compact. And then we will compute the index of U power M in U. And that's a very nice computation. So Lang says that the proof that he gives is originally due to Emil Artin, whom we already saw in Artin papers. Okay, so this is what we will do today. So let me start by defining what an inverse limit is. And it's a general construction. We will do it for groups. You can do it for modules. You can do it for other things. Okay, so first of all, you have a notion of a directed set. So this is a non-empty set I with an order, which we will write less than or equal to. It's a binary relation. So it's a non-empty set I together with a relation which is reflexive and transitive. And every pair of elements in A has an upper bound. If you have A and B in I, then there is a C such that A less than or equal to C, B less than or equal to C. So such a thing is called a directed set, and we will be using natural numbers with less than or equal to in the next slide. Okay, that will be our directed set. And an inverse system, so we are doing it for, or it's also called a projective system, and this inverse limit is also called a projective limit. It is, so we are going to do it for groups and homomorphisms. You can do it for other structures in mathematics also. It can be done much more generally. We will do it for groups and homomorphisms. It's a family of groups indexed by this set. We will be taking natural numbers. And so it is a family of groups together with a family of homomorphisms. And these homomorphisms, so given Gi and Gj, and these homomorphisms are also called transition maps. So what you have is, if I is less than or equal to J in this ordering, if I is less than or equal to J, then correspondingly you have a homomorphism from Gj to Gi. Okay, if I is less than or equal to J, you have a homomorphism from Gj to Gi. So this much is given to you, a collection Gi, and for each I less than or equal to J, you have a homomorphism from Gj to Gi, satisfying two conditions. First of all, it is reflexive, right? So I is less than or equal to I. So from Gi to Gi, you have a map Fii. That should be the identity map. Fii from Gi to Gi is nothing but the identity map. And then you have compatibility, which is that if I is less than or equal to J is less than or equal to K, then from Gj to Gi, you have a homomorphism given to you, Fij. And from GK to GJ, you have a homomorphism given to you, FJK. You can compose these two homomorphisms. So you will get a homomorphism from GK to GI. But from GK to GI, another homomorphism is given to you, which is what in our notation? FIK. So these two should be compatible. So FIJ compose FJK should be equal to FIK whenever I less than or equal to J less than or equal to K. Okay, so this is another condition that, you know, there should be some compatibility between these homomorphisms. If you take this and compose, that should be equal to the one that is given to you, Fik. Okay, and once you have an inverse system, you have the corresponding inverse limit, and you can show it exists. You can take it to be the definition. So it is denoted by like this, projective limit, inverse limit, the left arrow, so limit I in I Gi, so that's a group. And what is the definition? Because we are dealing with groups and homomorphisms, this is a group, and the definition is you take the infinite pro, I mean you take the product of gi, product of gi with I and I, and this is a subset of that, it's a subgroup of that. So you take all xi, the tuples xi in product gi with this condition: whenever I less than or equal to j, the jth element xj, you can apply the homomorphism fij given to you, that should be your ith coordinate. Your ith coordinate, whenever I less than or equal to j, ith coordinate and jth coordinate should be like this. So xi should be fij of xj. Okay, so you can check that this is a group. Okay, so please check it, it's easy. Check that this is a group, and this is by definition the inverse limit. And you have natural projections from G to GI, which is, see, this is contained in the product. So you have the usual projection. So if you have XI, if you have this tuple in G, then pi J will map that to XJ in GJ. So you have this natural projections pi I from G to GI. And then there is a universal property, which is given by this diagram. So what you have is the inverse system, GJ, GI, and FIJ map from GJ to GI. And you have this inverse limit, which I have just defined. This satisfies a universal property in the sense, and this with this projection, natural projections pi I and pi J. If you have any other group G prime with projection homomorphism psi I and psi J like this, then there is a homomorphism from G prime to G U such that this diagram will commute. Okay, so there's a certain universal property. There's a certain uniqueness about the inverse limit. Moreover, if your groups also have a topology, suppose these are topological groups, groups also are endowed with a topology, and assume that all these GIs are housed off in that topology, and assume that all these morphisms Fij are also continuous, then you can show that G is, so G is a subset of product GI. You can show that if you assume that all these are housed off, then this is a closed subgroup. G is closed in product GI. A product GI has a product topology. Okay, so if each GI has a topology, then product GI has a product topology. And provided the GIs are all housed off, you can show. So this I ask you to check. It's an easy exercise in point set topology to check that G is closed inside this, where this has a product topology. In particular, if each of the GI is a finite group, then the only topology, the natural topology to think of is a discrete topology. So whenever there's a finite set, we always give it the discrete topology. So if GIs are finite, then G is compact. Why? Because if G is finite, then in the discrete topology, of course, it's compact, and any arbitrary product of compact sets is compact. So in the product topology, product GI is compact, and G is closed inside a compact set, so G is also compact. So if GI is finite, then G is compact, because by Tychonoff, this is compact, and there's a closed subset of a compact set, so that's also compact. Okay, so I'm introducing this because we are going to use this method to show that O is compact. Okay, the aim was to show that O is compact, and I'm going to show that O is an inverse limit of finite groups. So I thought I'll just ask you, I mean, if some of you are comfortable in tech, see in this diagram, there is something which is not very appealing. What is that? I would have liked this arrow to be a full arrow, but I couldn't do it. So I'm not that savvy with tech. So this, I copy pasted this code from somewhere on the internet and I got this, but you know, this is not a full arrow. So I would like a full arrow. I searched for a little bit, but I'm not very comfortable with these things. So if one of you can help me, please send me an email, how to make this a full arrow. Okay, I don't know how much tech you know, but if you know, do send me an email. So what should I do to get the full arrow from GJ to GI? I would like it, you know, throughout this. I don't want this gap here. And this FIG. So
the command you wrote for the arrow must have been right arrow, right?
I will show you the command. So this is, you know, this diagram is using what is called XY pick and XY matrix. The arrow notation, in order to get a right arrow, you are putting slash AR bracket R.
Oh, then I'm
not. and fij will come here, but if I remove this and etc, then the diagram is not looking good. I mean, it is breaking, so I have to put both these ands, which was what was there in my copy pasted thing. But in my copy pasted picture there was no arrow, so the diagram looked good. So when I introduce an arrow, it's coming only half. Have you done xy matrix, Manav?
No.
Okay, anyway, if you Google or if you get something, let me know, otherwise I'll ask someone else. It doesn't matter. I mean, here it's understood what I mean, that it doesn't look very good. There is also this, do you know Tikzi? TIKZ, Tikzi.
Yeah, like a bit, like not much. I've made one or two diagrams using that.
Yeah, so these days people use Tikzi, it's even better maybe, but maybe one needs to be a bit more savvy to use Tikzi. So XY matrix is a much older thing. Anyway, yeah, okay. So... Or in Tikzi, if you can draw this diagram, then also I am happy. You can send me and I'll copy paste that. Okay, thanks. Yeah. So now we have to show that O is compact. So we have a discrete valuation ring O with its unique non-zero prime ideal P. And I don't know whether I introduced a word for this. This pi is called a uniformizer or a uniformizing element. It is the generator of, so this is an element of valuation 1. Which is a generator of the unique maximal ideal. And we have seen that P power I by P power I plus 1 is isomorphic to O by P as additive groups. What was the morphism that we gave? I think we gave from O to this thing, X going to X times pi power I, and that's surjective and kernel is P. So that established this isomorphism. And from this, now I want to write a general element of O. Because you have this O by P, an element of O will be like what? It will be an element X, a representative here, right? An element X, a coset representative of O by P plus P, right? An element of O will be X plus P. But how will be an element of P? An element of P will be a representative of P by P square plus P square. And a representative of P by P square under this isomorphism will be a fix a set of representatives of O by P. Okay, so it will be a representative of O times pi plus P square. You can continue this process, right? So what will you get? You can conclude that any element of O will be of this form, x naught plus x1 pi plus x2 pi square plus dot dot dot, right? Using this isomorphism, it will be something from O by P, where all these Xi's are representatives of O by P, fix a set of representatives. So it will be X naught plus P, but anything will in P will be something in P plus P square, but something in P will be of the form X1 pi, where X1 is a representative here, because that was your morphism, X going to X pi. And you can continue that process, so you will get an infinite sum like this, okay, formal sum like this. So any element of O will be of this form, and you can show it converges because, you know, pi power n is becoming smaller and smaller, no? So if limit of this, limit an is zero, then in the ultrametric world, we know that convergence follows. So that is true. So this is convergent. Though this is a formal sum, it's actually convergent in the p-adic metric. So Xi's are a set of representatives of O by P, coset representatives. So it will look like this, and now, you know, I'm going to take my directed set to be natural numbers and with the usual less than or equal to, and I will take my groups to be O by P power I. So these are finite groups, right? Why is this group finite? Okay, this is finite if I assume O by P is finite. Have I assumed O by P is finite? Okay, later I will assume, but right now it is O by P power I. I'm not saying it is finite. So GI is this group. Finite or not, you take this group, and for I less than or equal to j, you have a natural homomorphism, no, from gj to gi. So this morphism is from O by P power j to O by P power I. And what is a natural map? Natural map is anything in O by P power j will be like this up to xj minus 1 pi power j minus 1, and anything in O by P power I will be up to this. You just truncate, you just take, you know, the up to the I minus X I minus one term, and that's the most natural map from GJ to GI, and that's a homomorphism. So you take this to be FIJ. So it is you can show that this is an inverse system, right? It's obviously the identity map from GI to GI and GJ to GI and GK to GJ. Truncation, you know, is transitive, so compatibility is there. So it is an inverse system, and therefore you have the inverse limit. And what will be an element of the inverse limit? It will be something like this, right? Because how did you construct the inverse limit? It was a tuple where if I is less than or equal to j, xi is fij of xj. So if the first element is from O by P, if you take it to be x naught, the next element is something that goes to x naught. So that will be of the form x naught plus x1 prime. An element here will be something that goes to x naught plus x1 prime. So that will be of the form x naught plus x1 pi plus x2 pi square, etc. So this kind of an infinite tuple will be a typical element of the projective limit, inverse limit. And on the other hand, your x is this formal sum, which is convergent. So this series. So there's a natural map from O to this projective limit. O to this projective limit, limit gn, gn is O by P power n. And anything here is a tuple like this. And you know, if you take an element x, that is an infinite sum, summation xi pi power I. And there is this natural map. You can check that this is obviously an isomorphism. Okay, everything is very natural. This is an isomorphism. And now suppose, you know, you put each O by P power n, if you put the discrete topology, you check that this pi
is... What are the fij in this case?
Huh?
What are the fijs? Can you show them once?
Fij is this one. So on gj is O by P power j, right? Anything in O by P power j will look like this, up to j minus 1, right? Just this argument, up to pi by P power, pi pj minus 1 by P power j, you are going, no? So continuing like this, if you have a coset representatives, anything in O by P power j will be of this form. I is less than or equal to j, natural numbers and usual inequality. So I will be somewhere here. Cut up to that, truncate, forget the remaining part. That's the map. Okay. So it's clear, no, this goes to this, this goes to this, this goes to this. Under the relevant maps, you're just truncating. So you're starting with something, and that starting part is always there when you continue. That's all that it is making sure. Okay. And this is a natural isomorphism. And if each O by Pn has discrete topology, you can also check that this pi is a homeomorphism. Pi is continuous. So O has a topology. What is the topology of O? Topology of O is the topology coming from the absolute value. And what is the topology on the right hand side? It is the topology coming from the projective limit. What is the topology on the projective limit? On each GI, you have the discrete topology. So on product GI, you have the product topology. So that is okay, I'm not saying compact. That is the product topology. And because all the GIs are discrete and therefore they are Hausdorff, the earlier exercise would show that G is a closed subset of that. Even if it's not closed, whatever, you know, if you have a subset, it's the subspace topology. So the topology on G is the subspace topology of the product topology. And O is the topology coming from the absolute value. You can show that pi is continuous and it's also open. So it's an isomorphism which is continuous and open. So it's a homeomorphism and a homomorphism. So these two things are identical for all purposes. So please do check this, though these are very easy things, check once. So for example, in order to show pi is continuous, what do you have to show? You have to show that inverse image of open set is open. It's enough to check inverse image of a basic open set. But how does a basic open set look here? So this is subspace topology. So basically you are looking at a basic open set here. What is a basic open set in the product topology? This will be a finitely many open sets and the rest will be the full sets. So if you take such a thing under this, the map is very natural. So you can check what the inverse image is. So you have to conclude that. So what will happen finally is it will be a finite intersection of open sets and that will be open. So you can show that that is open. And similarly, you check that pi takes an open set to an open set. If you take an open set, by the way, you know, these are all have very nice structures. So it's enough to check in a neighborhood of zero. By translation, you know, you would have checked everywhere else because it's an isomorphism. So so take a nice neighborhood of zero here. So it is p power I. So check what is pi of p power I. So under this map, pi of p power I, check whether it's open or not in the projective limit topology. So you can check, it's an open set. If you have any doubt, you know, you ask me either on WhatsApp or email or in the next class, okay? So do check these things. These are basic things which you might find useful in some other course or in future if you continue mathematics. Okay, so this is a homeomorphism. Now we have proved that O is compact if each O by P is finite. Why? Can you conclude the proof? So we have shown that these two are homeomorphic, and suppose each O by P is finite, and then I am saying that O is compact, but this is a homeomorphism, so it's enough to show that this is compact. And why is this compact if O by P is finite? If O by P is finite, then each O by P power N is finite. Why?
Lyapunov's theorem. O by P power N is finite, so it is compact.
Yeah, so each O by P power N is finite because O by P is finite. And discrete topology for a finite set, therefore that is compact. So the product topology is compact, product is compact. And because of Hausdorffness, the projective limit is a closed subspace of the product. So closed subset of a compact set is compact. And therefore this is compact, this is a homeomorphism, so O is compact. Okay, so we have shown that O is compact. O is compact could have been shown without introducing projective limit also. For example, in Milne's notes, he doesn't introduce projective limits. He just shows that it is closed and totally bounded. So in a metric space, that's enough, no? If you show it's closed and totally bounded, then it's compact. So you can show like that also. So the converse is also true. If O is compact, then O by P has to be finite. Okay, suppose O is a discrete valuation ring, and suppose it is compact, then O by P is forced to be finite. So the converse is also true. This is easy. Why? Because O by P is O is a group, P is also a group, O by P is a coset. In fact, O by P is also a group, everything is abelian. And O can be written as, so what's the meaning of this? O can be written as a union of X plus P, X in O by P. These are all groups, therefore this union is a disjoint union, right? This is writing G as union of cosets. So cosets are disjoint. So because of this, and what can you say about X plus P topologically? What do you know about P? P is both open and closed. In particular, it's open. So P is open, therefore X plus P is open. It's just a translation. Translations are homeomorphism. So X plus P is open. And this is a disjoint union. So O you have written as a disjoint union of open sets. And therefore, if O is compact, this disjoint union has to be finite, right? Otherwise, you will not get a finite subcover. So from the definition of compactness, and because it's a disjoint union of open sets, the indexing set has to be finite. So it's true both ways. So O is compact if and only if O by P is finite. If O by P is finite, we showed O is compact by doing this construction of projective limits. And if O is compact, then O by P is finite as obvious from the definition of compactness. Okay. One more set we will show is compact. So recall from the last class that if you take units, our notation was U. Then if you define Ui to be 1 plus P power I. So exactly like before, you can show that U is also a projective limit. U is a projective limit of U by UN as N belongs to N. Therefore, can you claim that U is compact? So U is also compact. Why? Because U by UN you know, right? U by UN is finite. If O by P is finite, which we are assuming, if O by P is finite, then U by U1 is O by P star. So that is finite. And ui by ui plus 1 is O by P. So that is finite. So each u by un is finite. Therefore, the earlier argument gives you that U is compact. Okay. So By the way, all of you have done Galois theory, right? Galois theory was part of. I wish I could have shown you what is happening right in front of my balcony, but how do I show? Yeah, anyway, maybe we don't have so much time.
I see something in the reflection and behind you.
Oh, you can see already?
Yeah, in the window behind you, the reflection shows some eagle flying, some bird flying around.
If I stop sharing the screen, maybe it's much bigger, you can see. So, but at that moment, I may not get it right in front of me. Anyway, let's see. So if I finish 5 minutes earlier, I can show you. Well, let me see. Just stopping the screen and let's do this. This is nice. So these are some advantages other than the usual classroom, right? There we don't get this. Now you can see my in the full window, right?
So even when you are sharing, if we want, we can see you in the full window. We can pin you to the screen.
Oh, even if I'm sharing, okay. So I need not have stopped sharing. Fine, good. So let me, also, you know, the kites may not come in front of me exactly when I want. So, can you also hear the sound?
Okay.
It's a bit scary for me actually because they are fine coming very close. Anyway, so the question was, have you done Galois theory? Which course was Galois theory?
Algebra
1. 414, right? So now in Galois theory, you have done fundamental theorem of Galois theory and all that, no?
Yes.
And typically, were you assuming that your E over the extension, whatever you called it, L over K or E over F or whatever, were you assuming it is finite?
I think you were assuming it's simple and all that.
What?
I am not sure. I don't remember exactly, but I think we were assuming that it is separable and normal or something like
and
that.
Of course, you will assume because that's what is called Galois. An extension is Galois means it is separable and normal. But moreover, were you assuming that the extensions were finite for the fundamental theorem? So fundamental theorem would say what? If you have a Galois extension and if you have a sub-extension, suppose, so let's have notation, so L over K, and suppose you have M sitting inside, then the Galois, then L over M is Galois, right? And Galois group of L over M is a subgroup of Galois group of L over K, and you would have shown that the bottom extension...
We assumed finite, I remember.
I think you are assuming finite, and you will show that... the bottom extension is Galois precisely when that was a normal subgroup. And then this Galois group is a quotient group, etc. And you would have shown the other way with fixed field. Yeah. But for infinite extensions also Galois theory is true. Okay. But in order to, I mean, even the fundamental theorem is true. But then you need to introduce a topology. So you haven't done this, right? You might not have done this. So you have to introduce a certain topology on the Galois group. And fundamental theorem is true, not for any subgroup, but for closed subgroups. We're closed in that topology. So some textbooks might call that topology the Krull topology, K-R-U-L-L, Krull topology. Well, why I'm saying this is that's another place where typically students see projective limit in a very natural context. So the infinite Galois group, so if you have an infinite extension, which is Galois, you have the infinite Galois group, that is also naturally a projective limit. And therefore, Galois group is compact. Even in the infinite case, it's compact. Anyway, you can check. It's there in Lang's book, Infinite Galois Theory. Okay, now let's do a certain finite index computation. And we have done this last time, this particular slide. If you take a unit U in U, and then we consider this polynomial x power m minus u, and we applied Hensel's lemma. Suppose this is given to you, that mod u minus 1 is less than mod m square, where m is the power here, m is the degree of this polynomial. So mod u minus 1 is less than mod m square. By the way, I'm sharing the screen. No, you can see the slides, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. So if mod u minus 1 is less than mod m square, then what did we prove? So this satisfies the trivial case of Hensel's lemma. No, not the trivial case, the Hensel's lemma that we proved that time, because this is f of 1 and this is f prime 1 square. So this satisfies the conditions of Hensel's lemma. So the conclusion is that this has a root in O. So that means U has an mth root in O, which will be automatically a unit. So we showed that U has an mth root in U. Okay, so this we showed last time, last to last time in lecture 2. And in particular, you can conclude that U power M. So what is the notation U power M? These are set of all small U power M where U is in U. Okay, usual notation. In abelian group, you have G power M. Take all the power, mth powers. So U power M contains 1 plus P power N for N very large. Why is that? That follows from this, right? Because if N is very, very large, if N is sufficiently large, if you take an element from this, what can you say? If U is from this set, then U minus 1 belongs to this set. And if something is belonging to this set, then its absolute value is very, very less, right? As N becomes larger and larger, the absolute value becomes smaller and smaller, because an absolute value is C power N, where C is less than 1. Okay, so if for N large enough, if you take a U from here, then that will satisfy this condition, because this will be small enough, and after a point it will be smaller than mod M square, therefore that will be an mth root. So in other words, that will have an mth root. In other words, U can be written as some Y power M for some Y in U. So this is contained in U power M for N large enough. Agreed? So from this I'm going to conclude that already we have seen that the group U is open, no? We've already seen that the group U is open. Did we see that the group U is open? What was the argument to show that U is open? No, did we show that U is open? Certainly all the UIs are open, because UIs are 1 plus P power I, and P power I are open. What about U?
I think we just showed the UIs are open.
We certainly showed that UIs are open, and we didn't say anything about U. I think we said something about U.
I remember the part about the UIs.
UI was just about P power I. Okay, so let me just check whether we have done it. If we have done it, it must have been in lecture 2. No, maybe lecture 3. Yeah, you are right. We have done for each UI is a group. Okay, so yeah, we did do it, but it's not there in the slides. You know, it was this question, why? It was just this question, why? So we must have answered it. So why is U open? UI open because it's a translate of P power I. And what about U? U is open is also fine. That's also obvious, because what is U? U is the complement of P in O, right? Is this too small, the font? Should I enlarge it?
No, it's fine.
Of P in O, no. And P is also closed. So the complement of P is open in O. So U is open in O, which means U is open, because O is open in Q. Okay, so this also we said verbally, but maybe I did not write it down. Yeah. So coming back here, So here I'm using only UI as open, not U is open. So UN is an open subgroup of U, right? This we have shown, and it follows that so U is open. U is open also. I'm using U is open, and U power N is open, and UN is open, and UN is contained in U. UN is contained in U, and UN is an open subgroup of U, right? Why is it an open subgroup of U? What we showed is UN is open. Open where? UN is open in K, in the quotient field, in that topology. But U is also open, so UN intersection, UN is contained in U. And no, even if you, I did not know anything about U, this is okay, no, in point set topology. If you have something which is open and if it's contained in this, then of course it's an open subgroup of U, because open subgroup, I mean, what is subspace topology open, meaning intersection with the set is open.
Yes, yes, it's fine.
So it's an open subgroup. Anyway, we know more. We know that it is also open to short whatever. So UN is an open subgroup of U, and I'm going to claim, therefore I claim that U power M is an open subgroup of U. Do you see this? So this is the claim, U power M is an open subgroup of U, and the proof is this. Can you fill the detail? So generally what I'm saying is you have a group G. You have a group G here, and it contains a subgroup H. And what you know is H is open. And from that you are concluding G is open. So the statement that I'm making is, if you have a group G and if that contains an open subgroup, then the group itself is open. If G contains H and if H is open, then G is open. Do you see why? Right, that's all that I'm using, no? G is open, I want to say, and I'm saying that G contains an H which is open. Which is open. And therefore G is open. So can you give a proof? Maybe you can just write it down and see. What I'm saying is G contains H. G is a topological group, it contains H, and you know that H is open. And conclude that G is open. Okay, maybe these things are new to you, but these are obvious things. It's just a new topic for you. I mean, maybe mixing groups and topology you are seeing for the first time, though both groups and topology separately you know very well. So, see, these are topological groups. So what happens is all these translations, whether it's addition or multiplication, etc., all these are continuous in the absolute value, which makes it a topological group. So a topological group is a group with a topology, assume Hausdorff or something, and such that the group operation is continuous in the topology. So from G cross G to G, G cross G, you give the product topology. From G cross G to G, you have the group operation that is continuous. And from G to G, you have the inverse operation that's also continuous. Then you say that it's a topological group. Now, if you have G containing H and if H is open, then it's obvious that G is open, because G you can write as union of XH, no? XH or X plus H, depending on addition or multiplication, whatever is your operation, XH, union XH. Now H is open is given to you, therefore each XH is open, because the operation is continuous and multiplication by X has the inverse, multiplication by X inverse, that's also continuous. So these translations are homeomorphisms. So if H is open, then XH is also open, and G is union of XH, union of the cosets. So each coset is open because translations are homeomorphisms. And it's an arbitrary union of open sets which is open. Therefore, G is open. Is the proof okay? So G you write as union of cosets of H, and each coset is open. And therefore, G is open because arbitrary union of open sets is open. So that's why. So what you have shown is U power M is an open subgroup of U. Okay, so this Y is answered. And therefore, I am claiming, so there's another small fact, very nice fact from topological groups, that the index of u power m is contained in u, no? U power m is set of all x power m such that x belongs to u. So because x belongs to u, x power m belongs to u. So u power m is a subgroup of u. You can ask, what is the index? U by u power m, what is the order of that? That is the index of the subgroup. And I am claiming that this is finite. So this is denoted by u colon u power m. And I am claiming that this is finite. Why is that? I am using two facts here. One is that we have proved that u is compact. And the other is we have just now proved that u power m is open. So the general fact that I am using is, if H is a subgroup of G, and if G is compact and H is open, then G by H is finite. The index is finite. Why is that?
Same argument, right? The coset, you look at the coset of u power m.
So we have used it earlier. We have already used it here. Same argument, this argument. So G you can write as disjoint union of XH, where X is in the coset. And it will be a disjoint union of open sets. So the indexing set has to be finite because of the compactness of G. So because of the compactness of U, and because U power M is open, so U power M is open also required this Hensel's lemma argument. So, you know, we are putting many nice things together. And then a little bit of topology tells you that this index is automatically finite. Okay, so that's a very nice result. And now what we are going to do is this beautiful proof due to Artin, which is there in Lang. So I've copy pasted it from Lang. We will actually compute this index. It is finite, so it's an right. Whenever you know that a set is finite, it's very natural to ask, can you tell what the cardinality is? So let's compute this. Okay, so this is because u is compact and u power m is open. Now we will compute this index. Let's compute this. For this, take R. So this is the proof. Okay, I'm going to show what this index is. So instead of stating that, let's do the proof, and wherever we reach, that will be the statement. And the proof, this particular proof is due to M.L. Artin. So take R, a number which is large enough so that you have this inequality. So M is fixed, fix an M, and we are dealing with mth powers. So fix an M, and do you agree that you can choose R large enough so that this inequality is true? This will be some C power 2R, and this will be C power R plus 1, and mod M will be something, some C power something. So whatever it is, by choosing R large enough, 2R can be bigger than, so let us say mod M is C power S. So what will be this modulus? This will be C power S plus R plus 1, and this will be C power 2R. So you want C power R plus S plus 1 to be bigger than C power 2R. So how should you choose R? C is less than 1. So C power R plus S plus 1 should be bigger than or equal to C power 2 power R. So if you choose R bigger than or equal to S plus 1, then you are done, right?
Yes.
So this will have a valuation which, if you call S, then any R bigger than S plus 1 will do the job. So take R large enough, in particular bigger than S plus 1, so that you have this inequality. And consider the corresponding unit group, UR equal to 1 plus P power R, this R. Fix such an R large enough and consider UR. Okay. Now if X is a unit, do binomial expansion for 1 plus x pi power r power m. This r and the m that is given to us. So what is the first term? First term is 1. And what is the second term? Second term is mx pi power r. And what is the third term? Third term is m choose 2 times x square pi power 2r, etc. So you can write down the first two terms, and the third term onwards will be divisible by m pi power r plus 1 because of your choice, right? So m pi power r plus 1 divides pi power 2r. So the third term will have a pi power 2r, then there will be a pi power 3r, etc. All those are divisible by m pi power r plus 1 by your choice. Therefore, you have this congruence relation. Agree? Okay. And as we said, let S be the valuation of M, the periodic valuation of M. That just means mod M equal to C power S. That's what it means. And this congruence now implies, So where is this element? This is a typical element. Where this is a typical element in UR, no? UR is 1 plus p power r. So 1 plus pi power r times some element in O. So that's a typical element in UR. If you take a typical element in UR and take power m, that is of the form 1 plus mx pi power r plus higher order terms, right? Modulus this. So plus higher order terms. But where is mx pi power r? Mx pi power r, there is a pi power r here, and m has a pi power s because s is a valuation. So this is something times pi power r plus s. So this is of the form 1 plus something times pi power r plus s. So this belongs to u subscript r plus s. You agree? This conjugance implies ur power m, take something in ur and take to the power m, that is contained in u subscript r plus s, which means 1 plus p power r plus s. That is because this is has valuation r plus s and higher order terms. Okay, so 1 plus p power r plus s is what we call ur plus s. So you get this containment from this identity, this conjugance. Okay, but I'm going to show that this is an equality actually. This is not just a containment, this is an equality. So we have to show the other containment. So this we have already explained. And we also get the other containment. Ur plus s is contained in ur power m, and that's very nice. Why? Because you take something in ur plus s. Take something in ur plus s. So if u is in ur plus s, then note what is mod u minus 1. So this is 1 plus p power r plus s. So u minus 1 belongs to p power r plus s. So modulus will be c power r plus s. But c power r plus s is less than c power 2s by your choice. C power r plus s is less than c power 2s is same as saying r plus s is bigger than 2s, which is same as saying r is bigger than s. That was your choice here. So by your choice, this is true. And if this is true, you have Hensel's lemma, which will say that you have an mth root. U has an mth root. Okay, you have an mth root for U. Okay, so that mth root, so this will have an mth root, and that mth root has to be in, that mth root has to be in UR. You want to show that U belongs to UR power M, which means mth root of U is in UR, and that mth root has to be in UR, because otherwise what will happen if this root is not there in UR? You can apply the same conjugance and you will get a contradiction. This conjugance will show you that U is not in UR plus S, but you started with U is in UR plus S. So that will show this containment. Is the proof okay? If you take an element from here, by Hensel's lemma, this will be true because of your choice of R. And by Hensel's lemma, it will have an mth root. And I am claiming that mth root is in UR, so that this containment is true. If that mth root is not in UR, then that means it is in UR minus 1 or something, UR minus I. Let us say UR minus 1 for the argument. If it is in UR minus 1, here you have R minus 1, and here you will have R minus 1, and that will show that this belongs to UR plus S minus 1 and not in UR plus S. And that's a contradiction, because you are choosing U from UR plus S. Okay, so both containments are true, therefore you have this equality. So you have got this equality, UR power M equal to UR plus S. Why am I doing all this? I'm doing all this in order to compute this index. In order to compute this index. Index of U power M in U. So the strategy is to, you know, take a large R and bring in this U subscript R groups and use that. So it's a beautiful argument. It's not difficult, but it's very ingenious, very beautiful argument. You are bringing this extra ingredient R. See, finally the result is about M, U and U power M. There is no R in the picture. So you are using this catalyst R. Okay, it will come and do your reaction and then it will vanish. So U has an mth root, and so this we have shown, UR power M is UR plus S. Now choose R even large if necessary. Already we have chosen a large R. Choose it large enough so that there is no non-trivial mth root of unity in UR. That's possible, no? Because how many mth roots of unity are there maximum in the algebraic closure? M many. So there are finitely many nth roots of unity. So take R large enough so that URS, you know, much down in the filtration, so that none of them is there in UR. Okay, so choose R large enough so that the previous inequality is true and this property is also true. There is no root of unity in UR. Right, UR is a decreasing chain of groups. So as R becomes bigger, UR is smaller and smaller. So all the nth roots of unity will be somewhere in this filtration. It's a strictly decreasing chain. It doesn't stagnate. So UR strictly contains UR plus 1, etc. So there will be some R from which onwards, none of these finitely many elements will be there. So you can always find that and you will consider this natural homomorphism, which is taking the power. U going to U power M is a homomorphism because the groups are abelian. So UV power M is U power M times V power M because of abelianness. Okay, and we are going to apply the small observation. So I'm stating a very general lemma. It is proved in Lang, but don't look at the proof. You give a proof of your own. It's very easy, very obvious group theory argument. You have an abelian group and you have a subgroup B and you have a homomorphism from A to some third group, some C. Okay, that's not relevant for the statement of the lemma. You have a homomorphism from an abelian group to some group and you are taking a subgroup B, and I'm interested in computing the index of B in A, and here is a formula. You can consider the images f of a and f of b. F of b will be a subgroup of f of a. You can compute that index, and you can also compute the respective kernels, kernel of f in a and that intersection b, which is kernel of f in b, and you can compute that index, and it will be the product of these two indices. It's an elementary lemma. Please try to give a proof. If you can't give a proof, look at Lang, but you should be able to give a proof. It's obvious, it's easy. I'm going to apply this lemma to what is my group and what is my subgroup. Group is U and subgroup is UR. Again, remember, it's an ingenious proof in the sense I'm not interested in U index UR, which anyway I know. I'm interested in the index of U power M in U. But I start with this. This is A and this is B. This is A and this is B. So what will be this by this formula? It will be the image of A and image of B. What is image of A? Image of F. F is this map. So image of U is U power M and image of UR is UR power M. But what is UR power M? We have computed UR power M. UR power M is nothing but UR plus S, where S is a valuation of M. Okay. Therefore, applying this lemma, I will get UR U power M, the index of UR power M in U power M, but UR power M is UR plus S. And what is this? The kernel of F in A. A is U, units. So kernel of F in units. Those are the mth roots of U. What is the kernel? Kernel of this map. So that is U power M equal to 1. That is the mth roots of unity.
Yes. U and for V it will be 0 because we took R such that.
Yes. 0 meaning 1, trivial, identity.
Yes. Well, yeah. Zero group. I mean.
Zero group, yes, correct. Yeah. So these are the mth roots of unity in K. But a root of unity is obviously a unit. So whatever is there in K is actually in U. So this I will denote by Km star. Km star meaning this is a notation for the Km star is the group of mth roots of unity in K. And any root of unity is obviously in U. So that's my notation. Index of that of the trivial group. This is trivial. That's what Manav just said. This is trivial because of my choice of R. No non-trivial mth root of unity lies in UR. So only root of unity in UR is 1. So that is the index of 1 in Km star, which is the cardinality of Km star. So you have got this identity. And this Km star denotes a group of mth roots of unity in K, which is K is a quotient field of O. And now this you can write as what? Um index of UR plus S in UM. So that I'm going to write as U UR plus S by U UM, right? That is same as UM UR plus S, one of the isomorphism theorems, times KM star. And this gives you an equation for u um. This is what we are interested in. Therefore, the index of um in u is index of um in u is u ur plus s by u ur, which is index of ur plus s in ur times mod km star. But this is well known. This you know because each ui by ui plus 1 is o by p, right? So this you know. So in lecture 3 you have seen this isomorphism and also this isomorphism, and therefore ur index of ur plus s in ur, you know it is ur by ur plus 1 times ur plus 1 by ur plus 2 times etc ur plus s minus 1 by ur plus s. So s copies of o by p, s copies of o by p. So that is the index is s copies of o by p. So the cardinality will be cardinality of o by p power s times the number of roots of unity in km. So you have got a very beautiful formula for UUM, and the standard normalization of the absolute value is you take c to be, right, in usual periodic I said take c to be 1 by p. So the standard normalization is take c to be 1 by this cardinality. That's the most standard normalization. Whenever this cardinality is finite, are we assuming in this computation that the cardinality of O by P is finite? Yes, we are assuming. Why? Where did we assume? Because we assume that the index is finite. We proved that the index is finite, and the proof that this index is finite uses the fact that U is compact, and U is compact is precisely when O by P is finite. So O by P is finite, and therefore it has a finite cardinality, and the most natural normalization is absolute value of any x is c power something, and that c is 1 by cardinality of O by P, 1 by cardinality of O by P. Therefore cardinality of O by P power s is 1 by mod m power s. This is wrong. No, I should not put an AS here. There's a typo. What I meant is mod M, right? Because valuation of M is S. So I should not put S again, right? Valuation of M is S. The P valuation of M is S. Here, P valuation of M is S. In other words, mod M, the P absolute value of M is c power s, and c is 1 by cardinality of 4 by p. So I should not put s again, that's a typo. It is 1 by mod m. Okay, it is km star by mod m. Yeah. Km star by mod m, remind me to delete this s. Okay, in particular, suppose you know, so your field you don't know, right, what properties your field has. The field may contain all the mth roots of unity, or the field may not contain roots of unity. So suppose your k, it depends on m also, it depends on m also. So for certain m it might contain mth roots of unity, for certain other m it may not contain mth roots of unity. And it might contain some mth roots of unity. If it contains a primitive mth roots of unity, mth root of unity, then of course it contains all the mth roots of unity. So if k contains all the mth roots of unity, then what does this mean? What is km star? Km star is m, no? Because there are m mth roots of unity in the algebraic closure. So this is nothing but m by mod m. Again, there's no s here. M by mod m. Okay, so that's a useful result. And so why don't you tell me what is QP star by QP star square? Okay, just to get started, suppose you take real numbers. What is the index of R star square in R? What is R mod R star square? What is the cardinality? R star by R star square. R is real numbers.
One.
Two. Because of the sign, no. Negative numbers don't have a square root. If the question was C, then of course you are right. One C star by C star square is one, but R star by R star square is two. By the way, just curious, do you know what is Q star by Q star square? What is Q star by Q star square? I mean, is it finite or infinite?
Infinite, right?
Clearly, no? Yeah, fine. So let's do QP star by QP star square. And we can use this, no? Because we have already shown. So M is 2. So you know the index of U square in U. But what is QP star? QP star is P, the cyclic, any element in QP star, right? We have done, no? If you have a DVR, any element will be pi power n times a unit. So anything in the quotient field will be pi power r times a unit, where r is an integer. So in other words, the structure of k star is the cyclic group generated by pi cross product with units. So if you know units, then you know k star. So you know the formula for k star, the index of k star power m and k star, because k star is nothing but a copy of z, copy of by z I mean the infinite cyclic group, right? The infinite cyclic group generated by the uniformizing element pi. So k star is the group generated by pi cross u. So what is k star by k star power m? Pi by pi power m, the group generated by pi power m cross u by u power m, and you have a formula for u by u power m. And what is pi by pi power m? It is z mod mz, so that is of order m. So k star by k, so corollary to this is k star, the index of k star power m and k star is just multiply this by m times this by mod m. So you can use that. So qp star by qp star square, because m is 2, it will be twice this answer. Is it true that qp star contains the second roots of unity, square roots of unity? What are the square roots of unity? 1 and minus 1. And both are there in all the fields. No, so it does contain. So you can apply the last line. So the answer is m by mod m. But what is m by mod m? M is 2. So it is 2 by mod 2. So what is 2 by mod 2? What is mod 2? In the periodic absolute value, what is mod 2? In the standard normalization. Meaning C is 1 by P. P is 2. No, P is not 2. P is P. So what is mod 2? Mod P 2. No. Mod 2 with respect to P.
What does that mean?
You take the number 2 that is there in Q and that is there in QP star. What is the periodic absolute value of 2?
1 by p power.
So how did we define the periodic absolute value?
So 2 will be a unit, right? Like if p is not 2.
Depends on p, yes. Yeah. So that's what I wanted you to say. So you have to take two cases. Assume p is odd, then 2 will be a unit, in which case what is mod 2?
1.
So if P is odd, then what is this answer? This answer is, so as I said here, it is M times this one. K star by K star power M is M square by mod M. M square is 4 and mod 2 is 1. So this answer is 4 if P is odd. If P is 2, then what is mod 2?
1 by 2.
So the answer is 4 by 1 by 2, right? M by mod M times M. So M square by mod M. So 4 by 1 by 2. And what is that? 8. So this index depends on P. If P is odd, this index is. So if P is odd, this index is 4. If P is 2, this index is 8. And if P is infinity, what is the meaning of P is infinity? It's a usual absolute value. Infinity meaning usual absolute value. And in which case, what is QP? R, real numbers, and the answer is 2. So answer is 4 here, Answer is 8 here, and answer is 2 here. Okay, these are all important calculations. I will tell you something. Okay, so one more point. Maybe at some point we will prove. So I don't know, you know, there's a lot to do, and I have to pick topics from different chapters. So I don't know whether I'll do it, but I might do it. I like that proof, so I will do it. But if I don't, because we have to do other things, then just remember from this course. I mean, after many years, if you're continuing in mathematics, it's important that even if you know you do some other area of mathematics, it's important that you remember this, since we have done this much, that a periodic field, what is a periodic field? Quotient field of a discrete valuation ring, which is complete with respect to the absolute value coming from the discrete valuation. Okay, that's what I mean by a periodic field. Such a field has only finitely many extensions of a given degree. Okay, so if you give me an n, then how many extensions are there of that degree n? There are only finitely many. Unlike, you know, like Q, right? I mean, Q has even quadratic extension. There are infinitely many quadratic extensions. But in any degree, a periodic field will have only finitely many extensions. And the proof is nice and very beautiful. And the most crucial ingredient is Krasner's lemma. We might do, but I need to develop a little bit more theory in order to apply Krasner's lemma and do it. In fact, it's not just Krasner's lemma, but that corollary that we have stated, that will be used with a little bit of topology. So all these are contain, you know, a little bit of topology. The proofs contain a little bit of topology. Open by compact is finite is what? No. Compact by openness finite is what will give you this finiteness together with Krasner's lemma. The corollary of Krasner's lemma, what was the corollary? If you have an irreducible separable polynomial monic, and if there is a polynomial which is sufficiently close to this, then and if you have, yeah, if you take a root of this, then that belongs to a root of the original f, and they will generate the same extension. We stated such a lemma, and it's a corollary. I mean, it's that lemma that will prove this finiteness. And basically, it's like it's a compact by open is finite argument using that lemma. But a little bit more work has to be done, so we can't do it right now. But remember that the ingredient is Krasner's lemma. And getting only finitely many extensions is a useful fact. And a very general remark, not related to this particular course, but I don't know whether you have seen this somewhere. If K is any field, not, you know, complete or not, it's field theory, it's algebra, not number theory. Any field. But assume that it contains nth roots of unity, fix an M and assume that it contains nth roots of unity, and also assume characteristic of K does not divide M, then you know there is what is called Kummer theory. It says that the abelian extensions of K, what is an abelian extension of K? Have you seen this word, abelian extension? So this means it's an extension of K.
Galois group is abelian mainly.
Yeah, it's an extension of K which should be Galois. So you can take the Galois group, and Galois group is abelian. Okay. So abelian extensions of exponent M. In abelian groups, you have the notion of exponent. No, what is an exponent? X power M is identity for each X, such an M. Okay. So If these conditions are there, then the abelian extensions of K of exponent M, there's a bijective correspondence with subgroups of this field, K star by K star power N. Okay, this is what is called, this is part of what is called Kummer theory, named after the German mathematician Ernst Kummer in the 19th century. Okay, so this is, I don't know whether you have seen this. This is there in Lang's algebra, but I don't know whether this has come in your field theory course, Galois theory course. Have you seen this word? Okay, so it's a very nice thing. K star by K star power M controls abelian extensions of certain property. Okay, so this is what we are computing, no? QP star by QP star square. Okay, so something similar. These are abelian extensions, and Krasner's lemma application, but this is true only for periodic fields, is for any extension. There's no abelianness here. Okay, this is for any extension, and we know finiteness. And then there are, you know, questions of can you compute that finiteness, etc., where, you know, Manu's earlier question will come into play. The result that we stated was not effective. It was only showing existence, and that will show this existence of finiteness. But in order to compute that, you will need more inputs of, you know, various kinds of inputs. And this is a general remark, and I think it's a good place to stop. So I'll stop here, and I will stop the screen sharing. Yeah, I have stopped the screen sharing. If you have questions, you can ask me. Maybe I can even stop the recording. Class is over. I'll stop the recording and you can ask the questions after that.